Morning everybody! So today I'm going camping at Akagera National Park. So Akagera is Rwanda's answer to Maasai or Serengeti. It's our safari park basically. And it's quite easy to get to from Kigali, it's only a few hours drive. But I've never actually camped there. So over the years I've been maybe 5-6 times, something like that. But I've never actually stayed overnight, and tonight is that night. So I'm feeling slightly apprehensive just because the campsite that we're going to hasn't got a fence around it or anything like that, so you really are out in the bush. But I'm going with a large group of friends. Many of them have been camping there in the past before, so apparently that makes it a lot safer, but we have to watch out for hippos. So I've got beer, I've got food, I've charged my mobile phone, but I don't know if I can get any signal out there. So if anybody's in Kigali, if you see smoke signals going up in the general direction of Akagera, maybe send help. So this is all of my camping gear. So I've got a mat and I've got a sleeping bag donated by my friend Chantelle. That pillow isn't mine. Well, it is mine, but it belongs to the cats. The cats sleep on that. My pillow's over there with a towel. We've got a whole bag of snacks, including marshmallows, and a present for the birthday girl, shawl to keep me warm, change of clothes and some toiletries, and plate and cutlery and beer. So I think I'm sorted. So I was picked up by two lovely ladies, Sarah and Julian, and we just about managed to cram everything into the boot. Akagera is about 2.5 hours east of Kigali. If you're going on a day trip, you usually leave around 5 in the morning to get there in time to see the wildlife before it takes shelter for the day. We were leaving mid-morning as it was Umuganda. The last Saturday of every month is Community Service Day in Rwanda, so shops are closed and transport is limited whilst everybody takes part in local projects. Things open up again around 11 a.m. Technically, it's fine for tourists and Mzungus to travel during Umuganda, but if you're black and not Rwandan, you might still find yourself being stopped and questioned as to why you're out and about, so it's easier just to wait until things open up again. When you first arrive at the gates, you need to park up and register with the guards. You still need a rapid test to enter the park. You can get one of these for around $5 at any health clinic. If you're a resident and had your vaccinations here, then you'll get your results texted to your phone within about half an hour. It wasn't until we were halfway to Akagera that I realised I'd left my fully charged phone behind. My COVID result was on my phone, but luckily they let me in anyway. Once through the gate, you follow the road to the reception lodge, where you pay for entry. As we entered the park, we saw a small troop of baboons. I watched In the Shadow of Kilimanjaro when I was a teen. It's an 80s horror movie about a group of rampaging, bloodthirsty apes. A bit like Cujo, but with baboons. It still haunts me to this day. Park entry costs $50 for residents and $100 for non-residents. You can WhatsApp ahead to book a tent for $20 a night, but that is just the tent. You need to bring your own mat, sleeping bag and cooking equipment. It's another $25 camping fee, so $45 per night with tent. There's also a $10 car fee for normal cars. I've included links to prices below. Residents can get an annual pass for $300, so if you're likely to visit more than 6 times a year, that's worth looking into. But it only covers park entrance. You still need to pay camping fees on top. So Akagera is not a particularly cheap attraction. The park also operates on a cashless basis, so you can pay with Momo or card, but not hard currency. This can take some time as the network is pretty dire out there, and you'll often see staff standing around with their arms in the air, praying to the gods of connection. At the back of reception is a room containing some fascinating bones.
Can I get a size comparison? Does anybody want to stand next to one of these?
Oh my gosh. What are these bones from?
These are bones, femoral bones of elephants.
Elephant?
Yeah.
Leg bone, wow. Almost as tall as you. Mm-hmm. That's incredible, isn't it? And this is elephant skull?
Yeah. Also, this is the ribs of it, this one.
Oh, the rib bone.
It's the ribs of it.
Okay.
It's not set.
This is the trap, the bottom of the rib.
That's a giraffe, right?
Yeah.
Very much is, yeah.
And a hippo?
Yeah, upper jaw of hippo.
That looks like a horse, but it's not. Mm, what is it?
This is for zebra.
There we go.
Yeah.
Was a horse.
Yeah. It's also a horse.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Horse animal, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
That's so cool.
We did get a briefing which told us a bit about the history of the park and how it was 5 times larger before the genocide. But we didn't receive any information on what to do if you get charged by a rhino or come face to face with an elephant, which would definitely have come in useful later on. These boxes were used to transport lions and rhinos, which were reintroduced to the park a few years ago. This map shows the size of Akagera in comparison to Rwanda, in the top right. We're camping at Shakani Camp, on the shore of Lake Shakani, in the south of the park. On our way there, we saw definite signs of wildlife. We were camping with our friend Jessie of Quasar Brewery. She'd managed to fit an entire bar in the back of her car, including IPA, ambrosia and ginger beer. First order of the day was a drink.
Here you go, here's your ambrosia.
Thank you very much.
Swiftly followed by chasing a large baboon away from the tent.
Get out of there, buddy! Our tents!
Right,
get out of there!
Back in the car? Yeah, no, that ain't gonna work. He's going for the motorbike.
He's like, I'm taking off on this thing. Do I got the key here still?
Lake Shakani is a really beautiful place to camp. Unfortunately, my camera wasn't really up to the job, but there are hippos wallowing in the water a few yards away, monkeys up in the trees, and black and white kingfishers diving down for their dinner. There was even a herd of impala in the evening. You'll just have to take my word for it and make do with gratuitous shots of the lake. Also joined by an impressive company of bees, attracted by sweet treats and spilled tonic.
I think the tonic must have spilled.
No, because it's
these guys are.
It was a wonderfully peaceful afternoon, and I helped Jesse carry wood for the fire, which we used to cook on. As night fell, we gathered in the kitchen. Our friend Beth was in charge of the evening meal. She roasted vegetables in peanut curry over the fire with a lentil stew. Our friend Fatou made meat babies from mince, paired with secret aardvark hot sauce. It was so delicious, I'd finished eating before I thought to take a photograph of it.
Oh, there's my face going, hi.
But I did get a shot of the cupcakes for afters. Carrot cake and chocolate and caramel. They were delightful.
Hippo song.
I had a really nice time getting to know Beth, who is a conservation scientist at the University of Rwanda. She's been in the country since before 94, and it was lovely to sit beside the fire, watching lightning in the distance, fireflies and shooting stars. We were all sitting around the fire later that night, listening to the hippos, when we heard a slightly louder noise coming from behind us. It turns out an elephant had wandered into the camp. Jesse turned around and saw it appear, then shepherded us in an orderly fashion up to the shower block, in case we needed to take shelter.
Can you see him?
Yeah.
Where?
It's gone straight out, that way, I think out of the campsite.
Oh, yeah.
But the elephant soon turned around and left again. I didn't actually get to see it, I only heard it. This seemed strangely fitting. The last time I was at Akagera was in 2019, when my folks came to visit. My friend Emmy drove us around the park in the wet season. We got trapped in the mud and the locals helped us push the car free. Whenever Emmy took tours to Akagera, he always saw elephants and sent me pictures. Whereas I have never seen an elephant at Akagera. Emmy passed away last year, and this kind of felt like he was playing one last practical joke.
Morning, guys. Pretty knackered. Bit of a grey morning. A lot of activity last night. Elephants and I'm not awake. Oh my goodness. Please let me lie down again for a minute. Morning, guys. Welcome to my tent. it's a bit of a harsh night's sleep. Definitely not used to sleeping on the floor. So I forgot to close the valve on the sleeping thing. So it pretty much deflated in the night. So yeah, I've pretty much been sleeping on the solid floor, which I haven't done for many, many years. And like when you sleep on the floor for a long time, your body adjusts to it. But when you haven't done it for a really long time, like your hip and the bottom of your rib cage feels a bit sore. But to be fair, it's quite good ground. Like there's no stones or anything like that. So it's been fairly comfortable. But I'm looking forward to my own bed again. And there's definitely an added element of danger. So they said that there was a hyena walked into the camp the other night, and then last night there was an elephant. I'm definitely more aware to sounds and noises than I would be if I was just camping in the woods in the UK, where, you know, there's nothing more dangerous than a fox or a rabbit. It was okay. I mean, I like the sounds of the jungle, but they're not that relaxing when you know that they could kind of trample through a camp. I'm good. I'm tired, actually, but I'm here. Mm-hmm.
Okay, let's close up the tent. Take a little wander down to the facilities. Show you what they're like. Apparently there's a solar shower, solar powered shower. That's the wood pile. A bit damp. So this is the shower block. Above you. And well, that should be shut, but it's got like a fence on to keep the baboons out, because apparently if the baboons get trapped in here, they go a bit mental. So in here we've got two toilets, which are quite basic, but I mean functioning toilets. And then this is apparently the shower, and apparently it has got hot water. So it doesn't look terribly convincing. But I might give it a go. See, second shower in here. So two showers, two toilets, and wonderfully it's got a mirror. Morning. So yeah, I'm just gonna get myself cleaned up. Okay, quick camping and traveler's tip: wherever you go, always take spare toilet paper, because there is never enough of it. Okay, so I've managed to get myself tidied up, but stuck in the bathroom for a minute because it's raining a bit. Okay, I think it might just have stopped long enough to get out of here. Back to the tent. So this is the state of my room after last night. Stuff everywhere. The lake was beautiful in the morning, though the sky was overcast and brooding. made the most amazing crepes for breakfast, and we filled them with Nutella, fruit, yogurt, and a savoury combination of spinach and cheese. Late morning, we started our drive back to Kigali. Sorry guys, no game drive this time around. It was just a chilled out camping trip. Though some of the group did venture out and found a pride of lions and some elephants. We'll come back another time for that. Though Akagera is notoriously difficult for game drives, the Maasai and Serengeti are flat plains and you can see the animals from miles away, but Akagera is very hilly and covered in thick brush, so it's pretty tricky to spot wildlife between the branches. We saw a couple of warthogs and an antelope on the way out, but that was it for this trip. You can usually find buffalo, giraffe and zebra hanging out by the roadside though. As we headed for the exit, the sky became very dark, and soon after the heavens opened. We're at the start of the wet season, and at one point it was raining so hard you could hardly see the car in front. We stopped off at Imigongo Art Centre in Kayonza, which is a really nice pit stop. They sell vegetables, clothes, Imigongo, obviously, and artwork. As well as doing fantastic coffee. Highly recommended. Their breakfast burrito is delicious. The rain was still coming down full force by the time I got home. It was a wonderful weekend though, fantastic food, great craft beer, and excellent company. And although I found my phone the moment I walked through the door, I feel like losing it a little more often.